Good evening, everyone. Just got for the privilege that we can come together again and study the Word of God. Now, I hope your heart is prepared that we study. Listen carefully. I know and I believe not everyone will believe what we are sharing. Not everyone will embrace it. It was not everyone who was saved. The Bible says only the remnant was saved. Now let us pray. Father, we thank you that as we open your word, we ask for the Holy Spirit to open your word to us so that we may understand what you are going to tell us this day. We pray, O Lord, that you make this place tonight a dreadful place, that this will be the very gate of heaven, that we are about to decide whether we enter into the kingdom of God or we get out of that kingdom. Father, please open up our eyes and remove every distraction, Lord. Remove a mind that wandering far away for other business. Lord, help us that we may hear your voice. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, I will repeat again. What we are studying and what we are going to study this week, not everyone will embrace. Not everyone will say, praise God, this is a good thing. Some people will concern more about what they want to do. I'm telling you, Jesus says, what can profit a man to gain the whole world but lose his what? What's his soul? Now, we consider a lot of things. We say, no, I'm busy, I want to do this, I want to do that and this, I want to do this. Listen carefully, friend. The Bible says there will be a famine in the land. And right now, those people are taking this opportunity. Carelessly, they are saying, no, I don't want to know this, I don't want to do this, I have many things to do. Actually, the Bible says, when, you know, if you study Matthew, the Bible says that feast, that man, the king, has his son that had to get married. And the Bible says he makes invitation that everyone should come. That the unity, because remember this, atonement means to be one with God. Atonement means what? Now we're going to repeat this from there, from now until Sabbath. Atonement means what? To be one with God. Now, if we are going to be one with God, something must happen in us for us to do that. I mean, for us to have this. Something, there is a lot of things that need to happen. The first one is called sin have to get out of our life. And we studied that last night. We found out that in order for this to happen, we must look like Jesus. And I told you, we studied last night that we don't look like Jesus. We don't look like Jesus, friend, but we need to look like Jesus. And what is going to make us look like Jesus is the day of what? Atonement. Because atonement is to be one. If you divide that word, mean atonement means et. I didn't write it there. But if you divide the word, it's like three letters, or three words. It's like et one man. Can you see the word atonement? Atonement is et one man. Let me show you this. We saw that the storm, we saw the Sunday law, we saw that God wants us to set our house in order. Because unless our house is in order, we cannot be one with God. God cannot do, you know, God cannot mix with the devil. If we have devils, we cannot mix with God. We must first be willing, Lord, please drive. Remember, Mary, just remember, Mary Magdalene, she had seven demons before she entered in complete contact with Jesus. The demon first had to get out of her life. Now, there are many things that first need to get out for us to be one with God. That thing is called sin. And we studied like last night. Friends, atonement. This is atonement. Notice this. Atonement. This one. Atonement means et. Can you see this one? If you divide this in et, and then you have the word one, and then you have the word man. Atonement mean at one. Now listen, I don't care if people come or don't come.
Listen carefully. God wants to save everyone who hears this message. And God is going to use not multitude of people. He's going to use those people who are willing to follow Jesus where he is. Now, those people who are rejecting the message, listen carefully. Many people will not embrace this person too. They will reject it. They will say, we don't want this. Because to have a covenant with God, there are a lot of things that we need to drop off. A lot of things. That's why Jesus, when he came, preached the message, he said, unless you repent, you shall be what? Perish. So if there is no willingness to do the things of God, shall perish. And right now, all of us, many people say, oh, I'm busy, I have this and that, I have this thing and this. I have many things to do, I don't have time for this, I don't have time for the week of prayer. I believe that the president of Lamb and the president of Hessen, they announced that there is a week of prayer. But I can count that there are few people, that perhaps no one from Lamb or from Hessen. Now, my brothers and sisters, we have to understand that what Jesus wants to do with the Day of Atonement is to heal us. Now, we're going to pick up our Bibles. I hope you have your Bibles. I'm telling you, I discourage anyone who comes to church doesn't bring a Bible. Come to the place like that's worship, doesn't bring a Bible. You know, the devil is deceiving us. We go to church, we bring a phone. Is a phone a Bible? Friend, we have to have a Bible. We buy many things. We buy clothes, we pick up our hairs, we do a lot of things, we buy food, we spend a lot of money. To tell me that you don't have money to buy a Bible, that's not true. We have money to buy a Bible. Bible is not expensive. But just tell me something. If you are not willing even to get the Bible, not even to have a Bible or buy a Bible so that you can have a Bible, you are not willing to do that, what will make you to think that you are going to live with Jesus forever? Because the Bible is the Word of God. And you must have a habit of having the Word of God with you wherever you go, you have the Word of God. Now, especially, brothers and sisters, when we go to the church. Because when you go to the place like this, God is here. And God just wants to speak to us. I want to ask, how many of you are willing to learn tonight? Please, I want to see hands. Now, open Matthew. Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5. I want to show you something there in Matthew, the chapter 5. Now, I want to show you something. For those who are coming, just go straight and then sit. Take your seat and welcome. Now, notice this, what the Bible says in Matthew chapter 5. Let's read together Matthew, the chapter 5. Because today we are going to start about this, the Day of Atonement. We are going to study what is in the Day of Atonement. Now, they told me that you only have 45 minutes. That's what they told me. I believe there is a limit. They said there is a limit for the message that I'm going to share. And I'm telling you, there is a limit also for God. There is a limit for God to wait for us. There will be a time that God will say, it's off. Actually, God will tell to many of us, oh, then we put a limit to other things. You know, we put a limit to the study of the Word of God, right? So there will be a limit for the things of God also. God said there is a limit. And it's true. When my friend told me there is a limit, I believe there is a limit. God will not tolerate forever with us. And until we learn this straight truth, there is something which is called straight truth. Not everyone is willing to hear. Not everyone wants to hear this thing where they say, oh, your message is too much true. It's too straight. We don't want to hear that. But listen, the straight truth is in the most holy place. When we go in that most holy place in here, we found out that in a most holy place where the high priest is there making an atonement for us. Now, we sung the song. He said, also on the 10th day, there shall be a Day of Atonement. Now we are going to start that one. Matthew 5, verse 1. Let's read together Matthew 5, the verse 1. Let me know, but say amen. Amen. Father, bless your word as we open it. For we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. The Bible says, and sin the multitude. Who saw the multitude? Jesus. This is the big multitude. You know, the end of this sermon, Jesus said, be ye perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. That means there is something that we can learn from chapter 5 of Matthew. Because when we study that, then we see what this perfection means. Now the Bible says, he saw the multitude and he went up to the mountain, and when he was set, his disciples did what? What the disciples did? Now, people are looking at me, look at your Bible. What the Bible say? The disciples did what? Now, listen carefully. A disciple's job is to follow the master. Whether you're going to the river, go to the mountain, sit in the rock, wherever you go, the disciple's job is to follow the master. So if you say I'm the disciple of Jesus, but you are not following what Jesus is asking you to do, you are not a disciple of Jesus. So the disciple, they follow him. Now verse 2. Look, notice please. But please look to verse 2. Verse 2, the Bible says, and he did what? Now please, wait with me. I want to hear people. We are, you know, listen, this is not just a sermon, it's a study, it's a Bible study. Okay, we are studying. Now, and he did what? He opened his what? Mouth. Now that's very interesting. Because the Bible says, out of the mouth of God there is life. The Bible says, men shall live by every word that proceeded out of his mouth. Now the Bible says, and he opened his mouth, what did he do? He taught them. I ask you, do you want to learn tonight? Now because God wants to teach, and listen to this, when the Bible is open, God is speaking. And many people don't know this, because this generation learned something very different. They thought, when we open the Bible, it's entertainment. No, I didn't come here just to entertain. I'm telling you, here is the, we are at stake between death and life. Some people here, one day, if they reject this message, God will ask them, I give you 1 week to start about the day of atonement. You reject it. You didn't want to even go there. You say, what is this? I don't care. What is that? But I'm telling you, Jesus is coming very soon. You know that? Some people don't know that Jesus is coming very soon. As a result, we are living as if there is no end of the world. There is an end. The Bible says there is end. This sermon, there is an end for the message. They say there is a limit. 45 minutes. There is a limit also for the things about God. So there will be a limit. There will be a time that God will say, until here it's finished. No more. You cannot continue. Now, brothers and sisters, now let's repeat again. What is atonement again? What is atonement? At one man. Okay? At one man. That's the meaning of atonement. That means the day of atonement, my friends, is to be one with God. Now, before men fall into sin, remember? Before Adam fall, something happened. When they fall into sin, something happened. I mean, before they fall, they were in one man with God. Yes or no? The Bible says that. Man was perfect, but one thing ended his life, making him imperfect. But God says, I'm going to restore men back. And many people think Jesus finished everything on the cross and done. No, my friend, the plan of redemption starts on the cross, but does not finish on the cross. The evangelical churches, the Catholic churches, all these people out there, they believe that everything done on the cross. But we Adventists, we should not believe that. The work starts on the cross because the cross gives us, I don't have time to tell you that. Give us a chance to retake what Adam didn't do. Next time, maybe sorry. But notice this. Let's read this. Atonement. Atonement means that we need to be one with God. So if we need to be one with God, what we need to take out of our life to be one with God? Because it's sin that separates us from what? From God. So that means sins in the day of atonement have to be out of our life. Open your Bible in the book of Leviticus. That's the song that we sung. Open the Bible. Leviticus 22. Now we saw this. We saw that we need to look how. We must reflect the image of who? Jesus. How? Fully. We saw that. But my question is how we can reflect that? Because Jesus, we studied last night, Jesus doesn't see. Never seen. In his mouth, no guy. You know, when you speak angry words, scream, scares the people, all these things that we say, this is a sign that we need Jesus. When we speak bad words, it's a sign, it's a test that we need Jesus. Because if we have Jesus, my friends, my sister, if we have Jesus, we don't speak angry words. We don't curse people. We don't speak, we don't scream, we don't do that. So let's say we gotta go on, look like Jesus. And if this is the greatest work that we need to do. And if we need to look like Jesus, we got to go in the place where atonement done. Now, this is what we are going to study tonight. Now, notice this. We found out that God, Jesus, actually is the one who works in the heart. Our hearts are polluted. And we need God to work in our heart to change the heart. We found out we need to learn what? The most important thing that we need to learn is what? To know ourselves. Some people, they think they are righteous. So I'm telling you, some people, just because they put the suit in them, They put the, what is this, a Filipino, they use something else. What is this again? Barong. You know, they think, because they use something, go to church, look good, beautiful. I'm telling you, true beauty is not outside. True beauty, my sisters, is in the heart. If you are not beautiful here, you are lost. You can try to make up everything. I can show you from the Bible. The Bible actually said that true beauty is not outside. True beauty is always in the heart. The plan of redemption doesn't work outside first, work inside. Now, we found out this. We saw that Jesus actually is very beautiful. Jesus and we are demanding his life. Okay, we saw this. We saw that not to see our own deformity is not to see the beauty of Christ. So that means if I want to see how Jesus is beautiful, I must realize, I must know myself. I must know that I am a sinner and I need Jesus. And I'm telling you, it's dangerous if you are not seeing your life that you are sinning. It's very dangerous. That means you are in trouble. There are people who even claim that they are Jesus. We are in trouble. Now we found out that we need to learn to know ourselves. Now the Laodicea says, even though God said we are poor, miserable, blind, naked, they say that does not represent my case. I do not accept the message that you are bringing. I'm doing my best. I believe in the truth. Demons also believe in the truth. Now we found out all this. We studied that last time, but I need to move on because I want to show something. The Day of Atonement. There is in the plan of redemption, the work of Jesus are two. The first one is Jesus worked as a what? The sanctuary show us how redemption will be done. In the sanctuary, there is what we call outer court. This area. In the outer court, there is an outer conifer and there is a lake. In the holy place, there are three things. Three furniture, candlestick, showbread, cut or golden altar. In the most holy place, there is the Ark of the Covenant. Here is the place that we are looking for. Now, we found out on the cross, Jesus didn't redeem us completely, but Jesus on the cross, he bought us. Just like Jesus on Egypt. Remember in Egypt, when Israel was taken out from Egypt, a lamb died to take them out, but they experienced him to go on and change. But I don't have time to tell you this. Now, we and I have to move on. Why? What is the plan of redemption purpose? The purpose is, remember this, Jesus worked as a lamb and as a what? As a priest. All together. As a lamb and a what? If you are not answering, you are not finished very early. As a lamb and a priest. Now, notice this. As a lamb, he died on the cross. Remember the Bible said, and Jesus, the lamb of God, which takes away the sin of the world. That's the work of Jesus. Until sin is gone, the work is not done. As a priest, you go in the holy place, the most holy place, doing the atonement. Now, let me show you the objective, the very purpose of the redemption story is to restore in man the image of what? The image of what? Man. To bring him back unto what? Perfection. In which world? It was created. This is the book of education. I don't know if you read this book. Everyone should know this book. To promote, what was that for? To promote development of body, mind, and soul, and that the divine purpose in his creation might be what? Realized. It was to be what? The work of redemption. This is what? The objective. You see, the whole objective of the education, the object of education is to study this. But let me ask you this. Many people don't believe that God wants to bring us back to perfection. The new theologian, even the new theology today, teach that we are going to sin until Jesus comes. But if you study the Day of Atonement, you found out that on the Day of Atonement, we must be one with God. That means there is something that will happen in us. This is what we call God is going to bring us back to perfection. Now, many people don't understand what is perfection. Let me ask you this. People say, the Greeks say, the perfection means complete, and this, the Greek and the Hebrew say something. But my question is, let me ask you. Let's go to biblical perfection, not the Hebrew, not the Greek. Because the Bible was not made for scholars, it was made for common people, like us. Okay? I'm a theologian, I'm speaking by experience, okay? Now notice this. Let me give you this example. When men fall, okay, but before men fall, it was what? It was made in image of who? God. Is the image of God perfect or imperfect? Okay. So that means when man was made, it was perfect. Yes or no? But something
mar
the character of man. What was that thing?
One thing only mar
the perfection of man. That thing is called sin. So that means if God is going to bring us back to perfection, what must be done?
The removal of what? That's why Jesus, the Lamb of God, takes not just from the outer court where he died, but he also what? In the most holy place is the finish of the word.
That's why he's going to bring us back to perfection. See, people say, I will never be perfect. Really? No, it's not possible. I cannot stop sinning.
It's not about you. It's about the priest. Because this is the work of the priest.
Now open your Bible, Levit. I'm going to show something, Levit. Because we are going to find out that it's about, actually the Bible says the same thing. In Hebrews 6, verse 1 says that God wants to bring us back to perfection. Now I'm going to show you something very soon. When this perfection must happen in our life, I'm going to show you the day. I mean, not the day, the time that we need to become like that. It says, the very image of God needs to be reproduced in humanity. The honor of God, the honor of Christ is to involve what? Involve the perfection of character of his people. That means for us to be bring back to this, God must reproduce his image back in us because we lost that image. Now the next says, it says, many people give excuse. Satan is jubilating when we what? When he hear the professed follower of Christ. Are you follower of Christ? Are you the follower of Christ? He said, when he hear these people saying, what is what they say? They make excuse of their deformity of character. And he says, it is this excuse that they lead them to what? To sin. There is no excuse for sinning. There is power in it. You know, the blood of Jesus is not just to forgive us. Many people think the blood of Jesus' purpose is just to forgive us. The blood of Jesus' purpose is to forgive us and to give us victory over sin. Many people say, oh, I just want the blood of Jesus to forgive me. There's a big power to overcome every temptation. Now, let's move on. Now, I already showed you this, I think, last night. I remember this. I remember you that we studied this, that God wants to bring us back by faith. If we keep his commandment, we are going to reach a condition that he wants us to reach. Now, we saw the great work that needs to be done in our life. And we saw that we have a little time. Why a little time? Because of what? Why there is a little time? Because of national what? From now that we are talking, my brothers and sisters, we are very near to that. If by the passing of National Sunday Law, we will still remain the way that we are lost. I'm talking about Adventists. Because there is a time, there is a probation for 7-day Adventists. There will be, and the first probation will be for us, and then the second for the world. But tonight, I don't have time to show you that. Now, we found out the great work that needs to be done is that we need to look like what? And then we saw that how Jesus looked like. We saw that in 1 Peter, we saw how Jesus looked like. Jesus looked like that one. The verse said that's how Jesus looked like. And we need to follow his footsteps. We saw that. We saw that Jesus do know what? Jesus do know what? Do not sin. Now we saw that. So that means Jesus was sinless. Now we saw this. Now I want to show you this. The saint took upon himself what? The infirmity of humanity. And he lived what life? What life Jesus lived? Sinless life. That man might know what? A fear. You know, right now many people are afraid because they are saying, how is possible? I don't want to live and say, no, I can. Yes, you can, but Jesus can. Amen? We are weak, but Jesus is powerful and mighty to help us. He says, so that man might not have what? Fear that because of the weakness of human nature, they could not overcome. Now he says, Christ came to make us what? We started last night. That Christ came to make us partake of his divine nature. The nature of Jesus is not a sinful nature. It's a divine nature. He came to make us partake of his divine nature, and his life declared that humanity, read with me that, what is it? Read it to me louder. What's that? His life declare what? No, louder. What is that? Because this is written in a book called Message to Young People. I don't know if you have read that book, but let's read. His life declare that what? You're not even excited. Declare that humanity combined with what? So there are two things here that need to be combined in order for us to reach this. The thing is, we are disconnected to Jesus. As a result, we cannot make it. It says, if we combine humanity and divinity,
maybe that's not coming. The Bible says the same thing.
In the first John, we read that last night too. Now, let me show you. The second great fear is that if we understand this, then you know that his head will be crushed. Now, I don't have time to explain you this, but I have to move here. Now, wait a moment. Okay. Can I have my iPad or my phone there, please? I don't know where is my iPad or my phone. I'm just going to check. Thank you very much. Now, very good. Now, let's read. This is the sanctuary is the basic thing that we need to understand. Friends, listen carefully, my brothers and sisters. If you are Adventist and you don't know about the sanctuary, you are not Adventist. Did you hear what I said? If you are Adventist and then you don't know about the sanctuary, you are not Adventist. I'm sorry. But we can be Adventist tonight. We can become Adventist. Because Adventist is not a name. A name cannot save. Your dad, your parent can be Adventist and you will still be lost. Now, look what he said. Look what he said here. The scripture which above all other has been both what? And what? Central pillar of what? Advent faith. Are you serious? And he says, what's the declaration? What's the declaration? And in 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be what? Daniel 8 verse 14. When this prophecy was fulfilled? 1844. Since the time that Daniel received the prophecy, it went all the way to 1844. But listen carefully, friends. Listen carefully. What is the foundation and the central pillar of Adventist faith? The answer is in the text. What's the foundation? The sanctuary. Now, friends, the devil is robbed by this message. You cannot hear this message. Everybody teach about this in the Pope. The Pope is mute about this. There is a reason for that. The devil has robbed us the message because he doesn't want us to understand it. Listen carefully. If you lose the foundation, the building can collapse. You know, central pillar. Let me tell you. In the Bible, the book of Judges chapter 16. Remember Sansa? Remember Sansa when he was playing around and the Bible says his eyes did what? Nothing. And they brought him into the house called the Gaza house. And the Philistine stronghold. And when they was entertaining, they say, let Sansa do the sport and all this. Sansa was being old, and they bring him to the prison, and they took him out, they bring him there, and then Sansa was just there. I don't know what happened, but all of a sudden, he said to that little boy, he said, please, can you bring me to this, to the pillar of this house? Do you remember the story? How many of you remember the story of Sansa, that part? Please, do you remember? For some people don't remember this. You should read Judges chapter 6. Now the Bible says, Samson went into that two pillars. I mean, when he get there, the Bible says he hold the two pillars. There were two pillars. The Bible actually mentioned the same term. It says central pillar. And he says, Samson hold those and he prays. He said, Lord, at least this time. And he prayed, God forgive him. And he said, hey, he strength come back and he break those pillars down. And the Bible says that Samson that day killed or destroyed more people of the Philistine rather than any other time. Now, my brothers and sisters, be careful because the devil is robbing this message because he wants to destroy the Seventh-day Adventist church. Now, maybe you don't believe, but I have to show you this quotation.
I don't know what is the quotation, but I have to show you this. I have to show you this. Sir.
Yeah. Okay, let me show you. Let's read this one. The devil is wrong. This is the thing. What we are studying is the Day of Atonement. Can you see this one? We are in the great Day of Atonement since 1844. When our sins, friends, please. Our sins, something must happen with our sins.
That what he said. When our sins are by confession, repentance. So that means if I will not do this, not forgiven, not cleansed. If we confess our sins, it's faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us. It says, confessing by repentance to go before. So our sin has to go somewhere before Jesus comes. Before her judgment. Say, God does not what? Now accept time of the spiritless testimony from his ministry. Such a testimony will not be what? Present to you. The message for this time must be what? And people don't like this. People don't want this kind of message which is too long and too much. And he says, the message for this time must be what? People want the short thing. People want hors d'oeuvres. You know, have you heard about hors d'oeuvres? It's a little food that you eat, but you're not fed. You're not fed. It's just short while. I'm telling you. For the crisis that we are going to enter, if you are eating hors d'oeuvres, you're going to die. You're going to say, you will not survive. Only those people who eat strong meat, they will survive. Now it says here, God will not accept this kind of assembly. It's not the assembly you cannot be present to. We must eat something what's called meat in the due season. And I said, to feed the church of God. But notice it. But Satan has been seeking gradually to rob these messes of its power. Why the devil is doing this? Anyone tell me? Why Satan is robbing the message from us? Why the devil want to rob the message from you and from me? Can anyone tell me? Now I'm going to show you this. Here. The reason is here. He says he's robbing the message gradually of its power so that the people may not be prepared to stand. Now we found out on the first day that the reason why God gave us the third angel message is to prepare people to stand. The reason why God gave us the sanctuary is to prepare people to stand. The reason why God wants you and me to go into the most holy place with Jesus is for us to be prepared. The 144,000, they followed the Lamb wherever he go. When Jesus went in the outer court, they were there. When Jesus died on the cross, they were there. When Jesus went in the holy place, they were there. When they moved in the most holy place, they also moved there. As a result, their character looked like Jesus. They reflect Jesus. They have the name of the Father in their forehead. And the Bible says they don't speak guile, no faultless what we found in their life. Their character was brought back to perfection. Why? Because they came where Jesus is. Listen, my friends, if you are not where Jesus is, you will never look like him. Now, but tonight God says, I want my people to go into that most holy place where I am. Now, friends, listen carefully, brothers. Because this is the thing that we need to study and understand very well. Notice this. Now, we saw that the devil wanted to destroy the pillar. If the pillar is destroyed, notice this. This is not just a corner pillar. It says central pillar. So if the message is robbing from us, we are no longer Seventh-day Adventists. If I do not know this, I'm not Adventist. I'm just like other denomination. And God wants to train young people, young women. If they understand this, there will be no one will stop them. Not any leader will stop them. They will be true missionaries to them. They will go everywhere in the world proclaim this truth. Because this message will not only just prepare us, but will prepare the whole world for the coming of the Lord. The thing when before Jesus comes, the world will not go in the most holy place, they will go to Jesus. They will go there. When the national Sunday law passes, the Bible says, Revelation 18, there will be outpouring of the Holy Spirit upon those people who right now are preparing their vessels. There are many 10 visions. No, we have 10 visions. Some they are full, and some they are wise. The wise, they are keeping, they are make sure their vessels are prepared, that when God will send the angels, the Holy Spirit will be upon these people, they will proclaim the message, the whole world. The Bible says, come out of here, my people, and when they will come out, where do you think they will go? To the seven Adventists. But not the seven Adventists, the careless one, the one who is prepared with Jesus, the one who stays where Jesus is, the one who says, Lord, take my sins, I don't care what sin it is, but please tell me, listen to me, there is not any sin that Jesus cannot forgive. Every sin that we committed, I told you, there are many right now are trapped in fornication, pornography, adultery, and these things are even in high places. And the Bible says, if we want to be with Jesus, if we want our life to get rid of this, we gotta go to Jesus and say, Lord, and listen to this. Jesus can forgive any kind of sin.
The problem is not with Jesus.
The problem is with us because we don't want to give our sins. He said, give it to me. Because Jesus needs the sin. I'm going to show you why Jesus needs the sin. Now, I want to jump this out. I want to show you this. Now, let me show you. Let me show you this.
Anyone know what it is? Genesis chapter 3. You know what is that? Open your Bible in Genesis chapter 3. Last night, I promised you that I'm going to share the condition that we need to have in order for us to enter in the most holy place. But I cannot tell you this. I have to tell you this first. Because we need to know what Jesus is doing in the most holy place before we walk. Understand the condition so that we can go into that most holy place. Forget about Leviticus right now. We will go to Leviticus. Not forget about, but we will go there. Okay, I will be very aware of time. Because, okay, all right. I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, Jesus is here. My question is, are you ready to meet him? No, I'm telling you, Jesus is here. Jesus is at the door, the Bible said that. My question is, how many people in this room are prepared? You know, none of us are prepared. Now, Genesis 3, what the Bible says, Genesis 3. Now, is there any relationship between Genesis? Okay. Is there any relationship between this and this? You know what is this? Anyone know what is this? Huh? Sorry? Sacrifice. Okay. We will start about that. Okay, Brian?
The scapegoat.
The scapegoat. Okay, very good. Let's read Genesis 3 first. Genesis 3. The Bible says, and I will put enmity between what? This world when men fall. God was cursing the serpent. I will put enmity between thee and the woman. Remember this, please, remember this. I will put enmity between thee. Who is that thee? The serpent. Who is the serpent? Satan. I will put enmity between thee and the woman. The woman represents the church. Between thy seed, who is thy seed? The seed of serpent. And her seed, singular. And it shall do what? The seed of woman, what's it going to do? It shall, open please, it's in your Bible, it's in your Bible, Genesis chapter 3 verse 15. It says, it shall bruise what? Thy head, and you shall bruise what? My question is, how many people are bruised in this verse? Okay, some people say two because I'm from the Bible center. But I wish you could not ever say. Are two people bruised? One is who? Satan, another one is who? The seed of the woman. Now my question, who is the seed of the woman? Jesus. Wait a minute. Tell me my seed. We should know what it is. This is correct. Galatians 3 verse 16. The Bible said that. Galatians 3 verse 16. The Bible said that. Open your Bible. Galatians 3 verse 16. We need to understand this. There is a relationship between this serpent and that gold. I'm gonna show you very soon. Galatians 3 verse 16. Are you there? Please, let's run quickly. What the Bible said? The Bible says in Galatians 3, can anyone read if you are there? Because I'm not yet there. Galatians 3, verse 16. The Bible says, now unto Abraham, and he seed, where the promise made, he said not, and to seeds, like plural, as of men, but as of what? One. And to thy seed, which is who? Christ. So the seed is Jesus Christ. Isaac was the type of Jesus Christ. Okay? We don't have time to explain this tonight. But remember this. She was correct when she said Jesus. So that means the seed, okay, the devil is going to crush the, what the? The seed of the woman. Where? In the head or in the heel?
Heel.
But Jesus is going to crush the head of what? Say, now my question is, let's see. Watch. Can you watch? Look to the screen, please. I want to see everyone look into the screen. Can you look to the screen? Let me look to the screen. Look to the screen, please. I look to the screen? Okay. This is how Jesus is going to crush the serpent. Look at this. Amen.
Amen.
Oh, well, you deceived that you don't like me. I want you to say that. This, you know, remember that this is a crushing. Now listen. When you crush a serpent, what happened to the serpent?
Yeah.
It's finished. Right, my sister? Have you ever killed a serpent? I will kill a serpent. Long serpent. When you kill a serpent, it's okay. You know, when you strike a serpent, remember that bruise means to strike, to crush. Now, when you strike a serpent, my sister, can you crush it? Where you crush? Where you crush? What is your target? The tail? The tail? What's the way? Where you crush? When you crush a serpent, when you strike a serpent to kill it, where do you strike?
Wait.
The head, right? Michael, listen, in Africa, they are very dangerous serpents. If you get some little things and then you, guitar, and you say, okay, I'm going to crush you, and then you go over to the tail, I'm telling you, that serpent is going to come over you and it's going to beat you. And you're going to die. There are some very poison serpent that when it just bites you once, you are gone. Now, notice this. So when you strike a serpent, you must strike where? Now, praise God that Jesus, the Bible says, according to the, Genesis 3, he's going to what? Christ the serpent, according to the prophecy, he must crush it where? Not in the tail, but where? In the head. Now, let's go. Watch. Amen. No, come on, you don't like that. So, you don't want the devil to be crushed? Now, let's read that. Let's see again. Okay, amen. Amen. Some people want the devil to be forever, right? That's why they're not saying that. I want to give you another chance. Let's go.
Amen.
Okay. So now I can see that people really want the devil to be perished, right? Okay, so my question, what is the relationship between this two? Now this is a bit. Huh? What is the relationship between the two? We have 5 minutes. What is the relationship between the two? Please open the Bible. Let's read the Bible. This is the song that actually we are going to sing, Leviticus chapter 16, verse 8. Remember this, the whole chapter of Leviticus chapter 16 is talk about the Day of Atonement. What the priest does, what the people does, what the congregation does, what they need to do, all this. And we need to understand this because remember this, this scapegoat here represents who? Satan. The scapegoat represents Satan. I'm going to show you. Let's read Leviticus 16, verse 20. Are you there? Let me know by saying amen.
Amen.
The Bible says 20, and when he has made what? An end of reconciling the holy place now. And also the tabernacle of the congregation in the altar. I wish I could explain you this, but I don't have time. And he shall bring what? What he shall bring when he finish? Remember this. This is the end of the Day of Atonement. Listen carefully, friend. I'm going to tell you this. Listen to this. The Day of Atonement, remember this. There was a type of the Day of Atonement back then. There was what we call every sanctuary when we saw it already. In every sanctuary, there was outer court, holy place, most holy place. When Moses received the vision in the mountain, God said, make it as I show you. So that means there is a sanctuary in heaven. When you read Hebrew, the whole book of Hebrew, you found out, especially chapter 7, 8, 9, 10, you see that these chapters are talking about the sanctuary, especially of the earth, but particularly sanctuary in heaven. So everything that was on earth was a type of what is in heaven. For example, the lamb that died on the altar of burnt offering represents Jesus. Because John said, the Lamb of God, which takes away the sin of the world. Now this lamb, when he died, we already know Jesus as a lamb and Jesus as a priest. Now there was a priest on earth and there is a priest in heaven. Now in here, on earth, the law, there was also what? What is called scapegoat. And there will be also a scapegoat in the future. I've already done to answer the question. Now, friend, notice this. Let's read Leviticus 21. Please, let's read together. He shall bring, verse 20 says, he shall bring the life goat. Now, there was two goats. One who died on that day. Remember, the Day of Atonement starts in the morning, but does not end in the morning. It ends in the afternoon. Did you hear what I said? So our Day of Atonement started in 1844. Did it end it? No. But by the end of the Day of Atonement, Jesus must do something. And that thing is called, he's going to leave the most holy place and come down earth. You know, the sanctuary in heaven, the outer court of the sanctuary in heaven is the earth. And Jesus will come bringing the life God. I wonder who is the life God. Now the Bible says, let's read verse 21. 21 says, and Aaron here represents the high priest, or actually represents also Jesus, shall what? Lay both of his hands upon the head of the right goat, and confess over him how many iniquity? Now read with me, how many iniquity? Do you like that? I really like that. This is the reason why we need to give our sins.
You know, before Jesus comes, our sin must go to heaven first. If Jesus won't come and your sin hasn't been not there, listen, any time when you commit any sins and you ask forgive, Lord, forgive me, He forgives you because He's faithful. But don't think your sins are disappear, are not there in heaven. Are written there. This is like this. This is just like this. Your name and your sin. If you confess, you'll be written there. Sins for confess and also forgive. So the sins are there. But if you will not give your sins, there is a danger.
I'm going to show you this more, a little bit more deeper tomorrow. But let's read this. Confess over him how many of iniquity?
Oh.
Oh, the iniquity of the children of Israel. What else? All their what?
Transgression.
Please read it to me. All their transgression. And how many? All their sins. Now let's read it there. How many things? There are three things. The priest or the high priest will confess over the head of the life gold. How many iniquity? All their iniquity. What else? All their transgression. What else? All their sins. So that means all the sins will be on her. Now notice the next part says, all their sins, all their transgressions will be there. It says, confess all their transgressions and all their sins, putting them upon the feet of the gold. That what it says? Now please check your Bible, because sometimes we believe only what the minister says, but we don't look what I say. He says, put the sin where? Upon the feet. That what it says? No. What it say? Upon the head. There is a relationship between the head of this gold and the head of the serpent. Now he says, the sin will be placed upon the head of the scapegoat. And a fit man will send that gold somewhere else. What is the name of the place? What is the name of the place? What is the name of the place?
Wilderness.
Okay, let me read one quotation. Amen. The one quotation, I'm going to go back here tomorrow, but I'm going to read something with you. Now, this is what's going to happen. The sins, remember this, the sin will be placed upon this head, upon this head, amen? But I'm going to show you more deeply tomorrow. Now, I also will read this tomorrow. Some people know here, Brian know this, Advent know this, the Bible side know this, but some people, they don't know this. This is the fit man, and we found out that fit man doesn't mean he's strong. Fit man mean what?
Timing.
Now, I want to read this with you. This is the last quotation, okay, we'll pray. So let's read. And the coming of who?
Christ.
When Jesus will come. Is Jesus very near? Yes or no?
Yes.
At the coming of Christ. The earth is empty of its what? Habitat. And the whole earth is appeared like what? The desolate wilderness. Now the event takes place. That means the prophet is telling us what is going to happen is what? It's the event that takes place for a shadow, the last solemn service of the day of our what? Atonement. Now it says, when the ministration of the Holy of Holies has been over complete, and the sins. Are you Israel today? Are you the spirit of Israel? Yes or no? And the sins of Israel has been what? Removed from the sanctuary by virtue of the blood of the sin offering. Then the scapegoat was what? Present alive before the Lord and in the presence of the congregation of the high priest and confess over him. Read this in Leviticus. It says, in like manner, when the work of atonement in the heavenly sanctuary has been what? Then in the presence of God, and in the presence of the heavenly angels, in the presence of the host of the Redeemer, the sins of the devil's people. That what it said? That what it said? The sins of the devil people. That what it said? That means God's people sin, right? Those sins are in heaven. Those sins must get out of there. It says, the sins of God's people will be placed upon where? So that means Satan is the head, he's the scapegoat. Upon Satan, and he will be declared guilt of all the evil which he had won. Any time when you sin, it's the devil causing you to sin. He will be declared guilt of what? What is this again? He will be declared guilt of what? Of all their evil which has caused them to commit. And as the scapegoat was sent away into the land, which is not inhabited, so Satan will be banished to what? To the desolate earth and then what? And say, this condition we want for 1,000 years. This is the coming of Jesus. The Bible says when Jesus will come, I wish we can tell you, but we don't have time. It's written in the Bible. I'm going to show it to Revelation tomorrow.
that God will come as an angel and will place upon the devil all the sins of God's people. And when this will place upon God's people, I mean upon the devil, then the people of God will go to heaven for 1,000 years, and the devil will be here for 1,000 years. Something going to happen. I'm going to explain you more tomorrow. Now, my brothers and sisters, we are going to pray. Listen to me. Whatever is the sin that is in your heart, in your life, I have my sin, and I want to give this to the Lord tonight. And if you have that desire to give your sin to the Lord, because remember this, unless our sins go in there, Jesus cannot also claim the sanctuary. Because Jesus, I'm going to show you tomorrow that Jesus, to crush the head of Satan, he must use sin. If there is no sin, no cross. Let's pray. Reverend, let's kneel. Let's enter to God. You kneel there and then you talk to God. You give whatever is the sin, just give it to the Lord and say, Lord, take my sins. Remember that Jesus was manifest to take every our sins. And ask the Lord to make you one in this day of atonement. Father, which are in heaven, oh Lord, we are in trouble. We are in trouble because we have not understood this for so long. Lord, we don't have much time to study. We have a limit, Lord. And you told us there is a limit even on the cleansing of the sanctuary. But tonight we saw that our sins have to go beforehand, before you come and before you leave the most holy place. Before you leave the sanctuary in heaven, Lord, our sin may go there so that we may receive pardon, forgiveness, and cleansing. But tonight we pray, Lord, we have committed a lot of sin, Lord. In Jesus' name, through his precious blood, Father, please, oh Lord, cleanse us from within. Wash us completely from our sins. Wash us completely from all our unrighteousness. Please, with your precious blood, cleanse us. We thank you, Lord, for Jesus who died on the cross. But the work did not done there, but he had to do it also to finish it in the most holy place, so that the head of Satan can be crushed. Father, we pray and we plead, please, oh dear God, may help us that our sins may be forgiven. And help us, Lord Jesus, help us to be one with you in this day of atonement, so that, Lord, we may be prepared to receive the Holy Spirit, the letter man, so that we may go everywhere. As you say in your word, Lord, that the world will come and come in here. Help us, Father, we need you. We pray, oh Lord, for everyone who is present here. Oh Lord, even those people right now are struggling, and the Holy Spirit is struggling with them, and they perhaps have difficult to give their heart to you and whatever sin. Oh Lord, remind them, help us, please, that this is the time to give all our sins to you. We thank you for loving us. We thank you that you are not interested in condemning us, but you want to save us. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. I just want to say again, please.